Before starting, we are going to do a short introduction to remote sensing, which is necessary to understand the practice that we will develop later. So, first thing is, what do we sense, record, or measure with remote sensing? We study the electromagnetic energy reflected or emitted from objects. So, where does this energy come from? There are three different cases in remote sensing. In most cases, the sun will have emitted the energy and the surface of the earth reflects it, and thus the energy that we can see, we can detect with our sensor. But there are some cases in which the object, with its heat, emits the energy, and there are others in which the satellite emits the energy and sees that reflected. But how does the energy get to the sensor? Well, there are three different energy transfer modes. The one that we are interested in is radiation, because it's the only one in which the body that emits the energy and the one that receives, they are not touching each other. This energy travels in the shape of waves, electromagnetic waves. And these waves, they have wavelength and they do have a frequency, which are opposite to each other. So to a higher frequency, a lower wavelength, and the other way around. Also, to a higher frequency corresponds to a higher temperature from the body which emits the radiation. So this is what you can see on the left graph, the Wien's displacement law graph, in which shows at which wavelength do different bodies with different temperatures emit the most of their energy. And you can see that 600K bodies, which is like, for example, the sun, emits most of its energy, or the highest proportion of its energy, at the part of the electromagnetic spectrum, which is, we will see later, the visible spectrum. So that's the energy that we see. Others, like for example, 300K bodies, which is the temperature of the human bodies and mostly anything that is on the surface of the earth, they emit most of their energy in higher wavelengths, lower frequencies. Okay, this is something that you have to understand before starting doing remote sensing. Taking that into account, we get to the concept of electromagnetic spectrum. That's all the range of different frequencies that radiation can have, okay? And within the electromagnetic spectrum, we are going to focus on one very specific part, that is the one that most of the sensors that we are going to use cover. So this covers specifically the visible spectrum, which is the one that you can have, that you have in the center of this picture, and the infrared spectrum. So the visible, it is called like that because it's the one that we can detect with our eyes, but not the infrared. The infrared is only detectable through the sensors, okay? And it covers a part that goes from the near infrared, which is the closest part to the red, that is the last part of the visible spectrum, through to the thermal infrared spectrum, okay? Thermal infrared is the energy at which bodies which are at the surface of the earth between 250 and 400K, let's say, of temperature, emit most of their energy. So at relatively shorter wavelengths, for example, the visual spectrum, the sensor will mostly record the portion of the source, the sun energy, that is reflected by the surface of the earth into the sensor. But around 3.5 micrometers and beyond to larger wavelengths, the energy dominant is the one that is emitted by the surface. Okay? And this one cannot be detected anymore by normal sensors, and they need like special detectors. The thermal infrared can be very interesting for nature dynamics that entail changes or differences in temperature. For example, in this picture, you have the contrast between the North Labrador Current and the South Gulf Stream Current on the west side of the Atlantic Ocean, and we can see the sharp contrast between them and how do they mix together around the same latitude as New York. So the sensors in the satellite that we will use will record the value of the energy reflected or emitted by the surface for each band, because there are several bands, pixel by pixel. And this is the key idea for remote sensing, because the different objects at the surface of the Earth, they behave differently, so they emit different energy, different amount of energy, or reflect different amount of energy. And this is called the spectral signature of the objects. One of the most characteristic spectral signatures is the one for vegetation. Vegetation has a low reflectance across the visible spectrum, with a slight higher reflectance at the green part. That's why we see green in the vegetation, but a really high reflectance in the infrared, which gets higher the more loose, the healthier is the vegetation. This is going to be very important in some of the applications that we are going to use. Concrete and sand as well will have a high reflectance in the visible spectrum, also high in the infrared, smaller in the near infrared than vegetation, but higher in some part called shortwave infrared. Asphalt and water, they have low reflectances both in the visible and infrared spectrum. Water has a small high in the blue part of the visible spectrum, that's why we see water bodies in blue in some occasions. The wide variety of satellites that we have available are designed to target specific parts of the surface of the Earth or specific characteristics of it. And to do so, they are tailored to get some parts and specific parts of the electromagnetic spectrum that we have seen. The ability to target different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum is called spectral resolution. For example, here we have the Landsat TM sensor, which is able to take seven different images in seven different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum, three in the visible and four in the infrared spectrum. Another important characteristic of sensors is their spatial resolution. That's the pixel size of the image that the sensors take. Okay, for example, in this picture we have Landsat TM, the one that we saw before, and as we can see, their spatial resolution, its spatial resolution is not very detailed, so we can only see some roads, and we can see that in this case this is an urban area, this is Mecca in Saudi Arabia. This other image taken for the same area by a different sensor, Spot 6, is much more detailed, and we can see, for example, we can spot the different buildings and even the people in the Al-Kaaba sanctuary. And for on the other hand, these pictures usually they cover a smaller area, and also their load is higher in terms of the memory that they use in the. The Landsat satellite mission, from which we have seen a picture before, is probably the most important remote sensing mission for environmental purposes still working. It started as soon as 1970, and it's been ongoing since then without any stop, and now is still working. It's important first because it covers a wide temporal frame, and also because all the images, they are freely available for everybody to download and work with them. So it's a primary source of data for environmental purposes. Landsat mission is owned by the USA government. So the European Space Agency launched its own project called the Sentinel mission, whose characteristics are similar, although they are slightly better than Landsat, but they started only in 2016. this practice, we are going to use images from this Sentinel project, specifically from the Sentinel-2 sensor. This sensor takes images in three different spatial resolutions. With 10 meter spatial resolution, we have bands 2, 3, 4, and 8, which are in the visible and near infrared spectrum, and these are the ones that we are going to use the most. Also, there is images with 20 meter pixel size. Those are bands 5, 6, 7, and 8A, and also bands 11 and 12. Among these ones, the ones that we are interested on are going to be the bands 11 and 12, because these are in the shortwave infrared spectrum, and this is used for studying the humidity of the surface, on the surface of the Earth. And also, there are three images taken with 60 meter resolution that we are not going to use in this practice. One of the most interesting applications of remote sensing is image classification, which means knowing which land cover exists in the area that we are studying. This is what we are going to do in our practice, and this is done by specific programs, remote sensing programs, by using the spectral signatures of the different land covers that can be found in the surface that we are studying. Image classification has been used, for example, in order to see how the Amazon rainforest has been retreating during the last years. And this is an application that is very popular because every year we get news on how the Amazon rainforest gets shorter, less extensive. And this is done specifically using automatic image classification. So, in our practice, we are going to perform one image classification for an image that we are going to download, and we will do this in QGIS. There are other softwares that do this, but we use QGIS because it's the software that we have been using in the other open courses.